So broadly, this talk is two areas which I am covering. First, it is about what are the guidelines about definitions, how to identify, what are the things to be done when you encounter a patient having the sepsis. And in the last, the second part, it is a case-based discussion, which you might be frequently encountered in your day-to-day anesthesia training. So part one, international guidelines for management of sepsis and septic shock. Sepsis is a medical emergency. So in the next few slides, we should understand how to define what are the core component when you say the patient is having sepsis or septic shock. Important in the dealing the fluid resuscitation, which fluid, how much fluid, is there any role of the measurement of central venous pressure, use of the vasopressors, which drug and how to give, how to prepare it, use of antimicrobials, how to select it, how to give it, source identification, practical tips about how to take adequate appropriate cultures, and how rapidly you go for the source control. Classically, sepsis has been defined for many years as a syndromic when somebody having either confirmed or suspected infection along with features of sepsis, including temperature, high heart rate, high respiratory rate, and leukocytosis. But you can see in the various clinical settings, without having true infection, these parameters, that is temperature, heart rate, respiratory rate, and TLC, might be deranged, like in cases of the trauma, in cases of burn, pancreatitis, etc. Then people had tried to differentiate actually to define the newer definitions, because most of the times we actually overestimate or overdiagnose the sepsis because of presence of these features. Almost 25 years later on, the third international consensus definition came for the sepsis and septic shock by the various experts in this field, published 5 years ago, where the sepsis has been defined as a life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by a dysregulated host response to infection. It's very tough to remember. You can't actually apply at the bedside. Then how to define an organ dysfunction? For that, they had given objectivity. There must be acute change in the total SOFA score equal or more than 2 points. I can emphasize that I might having the CNS infection, but not a sepsis. I might maybe having the some lung infection, pneumonia, but maybe not truly really having the sepsis. I may have a liver abscess, but may not having truly sepsis, or skin soft tissue infection, or UTI as simple, but not having the sepsis. For being in a sepsis condition or defined as a sepsis, there must be a dysregulated host response. Means that because of the presence of any infection anywhere in the body, there must be some organ dysfunction, which you can define through the SOFA score. I hope that all of you must heard about the SOFA, Sequential Organ Failure Assessment Score, commonly being used for the critically ill patients. Must be, I am clear, I hope so, how to differentiate between the infection and the sepsis. Then second component, it is a septic shock. Of course, patient must fulfill the definition of the sepsis. Along with that, there is a persisting hypotension requiring vasopressor to maintain MAP of equal or more than 65 and having a serum lactate of more than 2 millimole per liter or 18 milligram per deciliter. And you had done adequate fluid resuscitation. That is a clinician judgment that what he or she feel that adequate fluid has been given in the background of the sepsis and ongoing hypotensive state. And the clinician bedside had decided or feel that he or she had given adequate fluid. Despite that, if there is a need of the vasopressors and continuity of high lactate value, then you label as a septic shock. So like if you encounter a patient having the mean blood pressures of the 60s, feeble peripheral pulse, of course, having the sepsis, fulfilling criteria of sepsis. And now you had given the fluid, suppose 500 ml of normal saline, BP picked up, now it is a sustained, mean blood pressure is more than 65 for next few hours. So then it is a not a septic shock because you had resuscitated and there is a no need for the vasopressors now. So that will not come in the septic shock, that will come as a sepsis. Earlier, there was a one more terminology used to be defined in the literature. It was a severe sepsis that has been dropped out from the current consensus definitions. So only two things, sepsis and septic shock. For the PG trainee, this is a SOFA score, very commonly being used in the critical ill patients, ICU patients. It has a six component. For each component, they had given the scoring up to the four. Respiratory, they are the three clinical. Respiratory, that looks like assessment through the PaO2 by FiO2, means PF ratio. The second clinical is that CVS, cardiovascular, your mean arterial pressures, it's spontaneously or maintained through your vasopressors that define the scoring system. Third clinical is that GCS, Glasgow Coma Scale. And other than the three are the laboratories, one is the platelet count, second is the bilirubin, and third is the creatinine. So you see, can see there are the six important organs which are covered in this score, and it's pretty well actually define your severity of illness as well as predict the outcome and mortality in the ICU patients. So everybody should be knowing this, at least the name of the SOFA score. It's commonly being used other than the Apache, you must heard, Apache 2 score. As the severity increases, the mortality increases. You can see there are the, some old pictorial graph where if patient is just defined as a sepsis versus septic shock, exponentially increase the mortality. If somebody had a septic shock, almost 50% of the mortality reported from the literature. Same thing. So there are the two important international societies which are actually regularly come out with their definitions and their components and evidences and their recommendations. One is the Society of Critical Care Medicine from the US. Another one is the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine from the Europe itself. They had given the name Surviving Sepsis Campaign. And from 2004 onward, almost periodically, every 4 yearly, they are coming out with some their new guidelines as per the evidences available. You see, there are more than 20 components they identify. These experts and the guidelines identify more than 20 components which are important while you managing the patients with the sepsis and septic shock. Starting the initial points are very important for the first few hours, then later on, of course, other aspects also to be looked into that. Like initial resuscitation, screening for sepsis, diagnosis, antimicrobial therapy, source control, fluid therapy, vasoactive medications, corticosteroids, blood products, anticoagulants, mechanical ventilations, sedation and analgesia, glucose control, renal replacement therapy, DVT prophylaxis, stress ulcer prophylaxis, nutrition, setting goal of the care. In fact, all are important for the better outcome. Few things they had removed from the as mentioned in the previous guideline, like use of immunoglobulin, it's out now. There is no enough evidence for blood purification, again out from the recent guidelines. Use of bicarbonate therapy also not advised at this point of time. So at least few of the core component, first few points I will discuss and see what the guideline says, what are the practical points. At the level of the PG, I am not expecting to go in the detail deep, but in the exam, you can be asked when your patient is given a practical case or long case may have a sepsis component. The examiner can ask for these few aspects. So I will try to keep a practical tips on few aspects. First important point is the fluid resuscitation. Especially any septic patient, you have look for the blood pressures. If there is a mean arterial pressure less than 65, and you have to think about to resuscitate with the fluid first. Lactate is a marker of global hypoperfusion. If you are getting the reports in the millimole per liter, then it is high if it is more than 4 reported. And if it is in the milligram, you can say around 35 to 40 milligram per deciliter. It is really high. It is an indicator of hypoperfusion, global marker of hypoperfusion. Sorry, lactate, it is not only increased because of your anaerobic metabolism in the sepsis. It is a various mechanism, including high production through the aerobic cycle. Low clearance in cases of the sepsis as well as anaerobic production. So all the three mechanisms play a role for this increase in the lactate level. Yes, once you decide, you have to give the fluid. Which fluid? Consider for always the crystalloid. It is a choice crystalloid. Avoid colloid. No recommendation for colloid right now. In fact, they are against for the colloid. They say only when you had resuscitated enough with the crystalloid and there is a some clinical things which restrict your volume overload, like patient is having the cerebral edema, like severe ARDS. Only few conditions where you should consider to restrict your ongoing resuscitation with crystalloid fluid. Otherwise, for you, for your answer, it is a crystalloid. Simple, even the normal saline. Simple, your ringer lactate. Simple, your any balanced salt solutions nowadays available commercially. Volume of the fluid can consider up to the 30 ml per kg in a single shot. Like a 60 kg patients, easily you can go up to the 1800 ml, means around the 2 liters. But what the people do in the practically, it has been given in the small aliquots like the 500 ml. Like a 5 to 10 ml per kg, according to the body weight, in the adult, it come around the 500 ml. People try to give and they again relook, reassess their patients. Patients is needing the more volume or not. Of course, you have to monitor the lactate. And reduction in the lactate has been very well correlated with adequate resuscitation. You have to consider to give the fluid once you identify having the septic shock. You have to give the fluid, whatever available, normal saline, renal lactate, doesn't matter. Whatever you have bedside, give it. And has to be given within first 3 hours. You should not come just by identifying the patient is having the shock, started the vasopressor and decided or thinking to get a feedback from your seniors. Consider always give the fluid as early as possible. Assessment of the fluid. Over the years, central venous pressors has been used commonly and being taught in my training period also. It has been used as a part to assess the fluid status. In the older guidelines by the Surviving Sepsis Campaign itself, they had a component while you are resuscitating patients with the sepsis. One component was that maintain CVP between 8 to 12. Other than your maintain mean arterial pressure more than 65, urine output clinical, central venous oxygen saturation, and the lactate. But this aspect of measuring the CVP and to maintain between 8 to 12 mmHg has been removed from the recent guidelines and recommendations. Let's see what are the evidences behind this, why they had removed. Though it is a very famous trial, in the examiner might ask you, because this is a very famous interventions 20 years back, two decades back, published in the NEJM by the Rivers et al., very famously known person, who had made the protocolized resuscitation in patients having the septic shock in the emergency. What he had done, once you identify the patient is having the septic shock, he had given a step-by-step approach to achieve the targets of first CVP, give some crystalloid. If you are not able to achieve the CVP, then look for the MAP. After continuous targeting the CVP, then once you achieve the MAP, look for the central venous oxygen saturation. Then if you are not able to achieve central venous oxygen saturation, consider for your PRBC transfusions, or if it is not with that also, then consider for inotropic like dobutamine. So they have some protocol actually, and they look the effect of this protocol. They showed that significantly 16% absolute reduction in 28 days mortality. Mind it, septic shock patient has a mortality around 50%. So very high mortality cohort. If you reduce up to around the 16%, it is a huge impact. So it was widely practiced throughout the world to go through this protocol last two decades. But we should understand about the CVP monitoring. I will come out later why the CVP monitoring has been removed. So first about basics about the CVP. Central venous pressure, it is in the central compartment, basically mainly measured in the superior vena cava, has been influenced by various factors, influenced by by incoming your venous blood flow, because of pressure changes, because of RA contraction, right atrial contraction, movement of the heart itself. So in the superior vena cava, the pressure continuously changes within a particular heartbeat. in all the physiology book, you can see there are the clear cut 3 positive deflection and 2 negative deflection. Positive side A, C, V, negative side downfall in the pressures because of X and Y defined. Why the A is because of the atrial contraction. C, the second positive deflection because of the tricuspid valve elevation into the right atrium. The third positive deflection, it is because of ongoing flow of the blood in the right atrium. X and Y, X because of the downward movement of the contracting right ventricle, Y deflection because of the now tricuspid valve opens in early ventricular decision, diastole phase. So when to measure, because in particular heartbeat, there is a variation. If you closely look for that CVP, either on the monitor or theoretical, so where we have to measure the pressure exactly. So it has been decided when there is a relaxed, complete, no flow C wave. So based of the C wave, if you are unable to trace the C wave, you can think about to measure at the once the A wave is about to stop downslope, then you can measure it. When to measure? Expiratory phase, expiration phase, not during the inspiration phase. So beat to beat variation in the pressure of the CVP, you have to look for the particular site to measure the central venous pressure. Not only beat to beat, it also influenced by your respiration, because in change in the intrathoracic pressure also influence your the inflow, your venous return. Like in the spontaneous ventilation, during the inspiration, there is a negative deflection in the CVP waveform. You can observe if you are monitoring the CVP any in your ICU patient, especially spontaneously, ask him to take a deep breath. You can see the lot of wide fluctuations in the waveform as per your breathing cycle. While patients having the on positive pressure ventilation, there is an increase of the CVP waveform during the inspiratory phase because of positive pressures during inspiration. So there is a continuous accumulation of the volume there, increasing the pressure in the positive pressure. So they are the various component within each to each beat, as well as because of the influence of your respiration. So these were the basic physiologically things, very difficult to identify. Your monitor actually tells some digit depend upon the algorithm defined by the various basic studies, scientists, and they give a particular average value. Okay. What the clinical interpretation of using this CVP to predict fluid responsiveness? So this again, very important meta-analysis published in 13. Multiple various studies, they looked where the CVP measurement was assessed for the fluid responsiveness. They included in their meta-analysis studies from the ICU, studies from the OR, even the human voluntary one study. In their analysis and the conclusion, reading their words, there is no data to support the widespread practice of using CVP to guide fluid therapy. This approach to fluid resuscitation is without a scientific basis and should be abandoned. There was an inference from the available studies, reports, results. Yes, of course, you can use the CVP as a train in the same patient, same cardiac status. You can use it. People still advocate to use it, but do not go very rigid about the particular digit. Like patient may having the CVP of 15, still patient may have a fluid deficit because of the poor cardiac function. Patient may have a CVP of 8, but there is no need for your giving the fluid, or maybe just CVP of the 4. Because there may be not need at all to give the fluid resuscitation in that patient. So should not jump on the just value of the CVP in day-to-day practice. Again, now the recent good trials, three trials, 2014 and 15 from different part of the world, almost same time, arise from the Australia, New Zealand, PROMISE from the UK, European, PROCESS from the American. What they look in the emergencies, patient coming with the septic shock, nowadays there is no mortality benefit if you go for, as I described you, early goal-directed therapy, EGDT, what was defined by Rivers et al. Almost 2 decades ago. They say no need to go for protocolized fluid resuscitation. It is a various general care or clinical assessment. So practice has been changed in fact 2 decades, and despite not using the early goal therapy, these are the randomized trial. So they had gone the standard practice as well as the early goal directed therapy. So after the 2 decades, that doesn't hold true to go for protocolized fluid resuscitation, looking for CVP, MAP, then SCVO2. So I hope so. The point is very clear. Do not too be strict with your digits while you're resuscitating your fluid. So again, the emphasis, any number can be right or wrong, doesn't matter. So do not fix your ideas with your particular digit. So what are the things which define the volume status in the sick patients? Now people has identified such as static indices and dynamic indices. Static, you measure the pressure either, or you measure the volume at particular point of time. Pressometric indices, CVP, like pulmonary artery occlusion pressure. Volumetric indices, either you look for echocardiographically, right or left ventricular end-diastolic volume, or area, or intrathoracic blood volume, or global end-diastolic volume. But these are considered as a static. In fact, each variation in the heart cycle and the respiration, there is a variation which influences, and that parameter now considered as a better way to predict fluid status, that called as a dynamic indices. Three terminologies being defined: systolic pressure variation, pulse pressure variation, stroke volume variation. The word is a variation, it is a during the one breath cycle, how your systolic pressure changes during inspiration and expiration, how your pulse pressure changes during inspiration and expiration, how your stroke volume changes during the inspiration and expiration phase. Actually, through those observations, you can define patient is having the fluid deficit or not. This can come as a short recent advances, because many times short notes can come for this to assess the volume status, where you can write this classification or some brief notes about static indices as well as dynamic indices. So now I hope that you must be clear that CVP is a static hemodynamic index, and it is not a very good observation to identify the fluid status. This is again through their studies only. The pulse pressure variation, PPV, systolic pressure variation, SPV, stroke volume variation, SVV. They are having very high good correlationship with volume status. Why I am saying so? to highlighting, because ultimately these parameter, these digits will tell the clinician to give or not to give fluid. If you under resuscitate the patient, there is a problem. If you give extra fluid, there is also problem. If you doesn't give adequate fluid, there is a chances that organ may further damage, like a renal dysfunction will worsen. There is ongoing endothelial dysfunctions. Okay, at the cellular level also, the organ dysfunction is a very likelihood if patient is having the continue volume deficit in the shock state. On the other hand, if you give the extra fluid, overzealous fluid in the septic shock patients, the side effect of the fluid, extra fluid will creep up, including hyperchloremic acidosis. There is a fluid overload, including the lungs, hypoxemia may worsen, your bowel wall edema, gut may be edematous, your problems may happen in the subsequent days with the wound healing, and that also lead to the multi-organ failure. So appropriate fluid balance is the actually very important while you're dealing with the septic shock. Should avoid the under resuscitation, should avoid the over resuscitation. Just coming to the some few definitions. In the exam, examiners can ask for the few things. Daily fluid balance, how you actually evaluate your fluid. One is the clinical side, another one you going through the your chart, daily medical record. So daily, if you see in the ward rounds, your PAC, there is a daily fluid balance being daily measured for each hospitalized patients, where the fluid is a very important aspect. So they write the daily fluid balance. Then it is a very simple, no need to explain further. Cumulative fluid balance, it is a daily positive or negative fluid balance you add on continuously. Then at that particular point of time, it will tell how much ml or liter is percentage of fluid positive or negative. It can be any time period. You can say last 3 days, cumulative fluid balance is this. Last 5 days, cumulative fluid balance is this, or since the hospitalization, the cumulative fluid balance is this. The time you have to define. Another terminology being used, the fluid overload. When we frequently use the fluid overload, to define it, it is defined as a when there is a 10% increase of your normal for that particular patient's fluid status. If it is increased, then called as a fluid overload. In a simple word, I would say, like 60 kg patients is admitted to you over a few days, next few days with ongoing resuscitation. If he or she had a weight more than 66 kg, then you can say it is a fluid overload. Nowadays, for the ICU, most of the ICU having the weighing weights, means you can having the weight of the patients on the daily basis. So this is for the definition fluid overload, but people say seeing the some edematous, yes, looks like the fluid overload. But for the defining the things, 10% increase, it is called as a fluid overload. About few terminology while you are resuscitating, fluid bolus, fluid challenge, and fluid responsiveness. Fluid bolus, you say give the fluid bolus, what it means? Surviving sepsis campaign guidelines say up to the 30 ml per kg. It is huge, you may be afraid to give 2 liter straight away. So it is not like this one. Fluid bolus can be given in the small volume also. That's why they written in the definitions, at least 4 ml per kg of body weight, given in a brief period of time, 10 to 15 or 20 minutes or so. 60 kg, so what it means, 250 ml, okay? 70 kg, 300 ml. So at least 250 to 300 ml of the fluid to be given in the small brief period of time will be called as a fluid bolus. It can be higher side also. Fluid challenge. You are giving the challenge to something to look for that. So if you are looking, assessing hemodynamic parameter while you are giving the fluid, and your target, your primary target is assessing your hemodynamic parameters by giving the fluid challenge, then it is called as fluid challenge. It can be volume, can be as small as 100 to 200 ml in a brief period of time. Depend upon the modality. Your transthoracic echocardiography or transesophageal echocardiography or cardiac output monitoring device, you can measure it. And once you measure it while giving the small volume of the fluid and looking that change, that called a fluid challenge. It is a response from the patients or particular receiving patients, responsive or not responsive. So if there is an increase in the cardiac output, then you say it is a responsive patient or the particular recipient may not be responsive. So responsiveness, of course, will be looked by looking the cardiac output. These heart rate and the blood pressures are the crude parameter. So we very uncommonly look for the cardiac output. It is not a daily practice. So fluid responsiveness is basically if somebody is saying that by looking the heart rate and the blood pressure, they are the crude parameters. Ideal, your answer should be looking the cardiac output change while giving a small bolus of the fluid. And if it is increased, you will say fluid responsiveness. I hope so. This terminology, you are clear. So summarizing, the fluids are like drugs. They should be prescribed in the same manner as other drugs. That it should be very much clear while you're writing of any description, any prescription of the fluid therapy, what type of the fluid, how much, how the rate, and what should be the end point in almost whenever you prescribe any fluid. In perioperative period, should be clear which fluid, how much rate, and till when you want to give that fluid. So treat as a drugs. Coming back to the sepsis patient, septic shock patients, important component was the lactate in our definitions of the septic shock. It is a marker of the global hypoperfusion, as I told you. And the initial lactate values tell you the prognosticate outcome, even short outcome and the long outcome up to the 28 days, 4 weeks, usually take for the ICU patients. So once you receive a patient, look, first time encountering a patient with high lactate, high probability of mortality. These patients need more attention, your early resuscitation. Sepsis patient, you have to simultaneously think where is the source of the sepsis. So you have to collect the appropriate sample, because if you miss the initial cultures, initial sample, your long-term targeted therapy, you may not able to know what the bugs patient had in the beginning. Collect as early as possible. Collect before giving the antimicrobials. Blood cultures, always, even the patient having the pneumonia, consider to take a blood culture. Even the patient having the complicated UTI, skin soft tissue infection, always. Other than site-specific cultures, consider to take a blood culture. For the blood culture, at least two sites. So it is clear in the septic shock patient and sepsis patient, consider to take a blood culture also, and from the two sites. two sites means at least one site should be drawn percutaneously. Patient may have in the cannula, central line, dialysis catheter from the previous hospital. So you can take one from that side, another from the direct puncture. Take almost minimum 20 ml from each side. 20 ml, then if you take, suppose patient doesn't have any cannula or IV access that time, take one side from the right elbow, another from the left elbow, 20 ml each. Then out of 20 ml, put 10 ml in the aerobic bottle, 10 ml in anaerobic bottle. So these are the minimum blood cultures. You should not take only just 10 ml of blood. So appropriate amount is also very important. The chances of yield is better. As I told you, other cultures appropriate, maybe deep seated, ultrasound guided, needle aspiration, or some wound debridement, you can send for the culture if appropriate. For the diagnosis, take a help of imaging. Nowadays, it's very commonly being used. Ultrasound, CT scan, MRI also, deep-seated infections. Always take a help of these imaging. Emphasis again, when you consider blood culture clear, take a blood culture when you have a first time encountering a patient having the sepsis. Take a blood culture, take from the two sides. Antimicrobial therapy, it can be asked again in the exam. Delaying, even the hourly delaying in the giving the first antimicrobials, it actually have impact on the mortality directly. So each hour matter a lot while giving the antibiotic. Consider as early as possible antimicrobials appropriately, because it has impact on the outcome. If you are going the first time seeing the patient in the emergency or your ICU duties, patient came first time, not received, take a culture, give antimicrobial broad spectrum. First, and depend upon the site of infection. Antimicrobial, it is not straightforward to define which antibiotic. Choosing antimicrobial, you can say it is a puzzle. You have to consider the various aspects, like which site patient might be having the infection. That particular site, that particular drug is reaching or not. Patient's pathophysiology, derangement like renal dysfunctions, hepatic dysfunction also can influence the choosing of antimicrobials. What kind of the pathogens you are expecting? Because many times you expect few particular infection by just clinical presentation or from the source or from where the patient is coming from the previous hospital, you can think what kind of the pathogens. So all these aspects actually define and decide your antimicrobial particular in that particular patient. For the PG students, again, coming back to the some definitions of, it may be useful to clarify here. We say various terminology while prescribing the antimicrobials: empiric, broad spectrum, targeted or definitive, multi-drug, combination. Empiric, we don't know. We have to give, just we don't know what kind of the infection, which is the site, whatever. We don't know the pathogen basically. You may be right in the site identifying this is a skin soft tissue or UTI by clinical presentation, but you don't know the pathogen, but you give the empiric. It may be single drug or two drugs, doesn't matter, but you doesn't know the pathogen and giving the antimicrobial, it is empiric. Broad spectrum, by the nature of the antibiotic itself, actually it cover a lot of the pathogen, it kill a lot of the pathogen. But you don't know the pathogen, but you try to give antibiotic which can kill multiple pathogens. So this is basically for the antimicrobials, broad spectrum. It may be again the single, like piperacillin tazobactam, it is a broad, considered as a broad spectrum antimicrobial. Vancomycin, it doesn't have a spectrum of broad, but if you combined with vancomycin with piperacillin tazobactam, then it's a multi-drug and it is a broad spectrum. Targeted definitive antimicrobials, when you know. So it is a very important, when you know the pathogens, you know the report, and you are targeting that pathogens, and the patient is needing the antimicrobials, then you say it is a targeted or definitive therapy. Again, it may be single or multiple antimicrobials. Multi-drugs, again, terminology being used various time, when you doesn't know the pathogens, or if you know the pathogens, but it is drug resistant to various antimicrobials and you are using actually, then you say it is a multi-drug antimicrobial therapy. Very important terminology, which is being confused many times, it is about the combination. Combination antimicrobial, when, how we define it. So in this terminology, when you either know or not knowing, doesn't matter, but you use two antimicrobials for particular pathogens, either suspected or known, means you are hitting with the two missile with the one target, then it is considered as a combination, I will say you. Like target is one, like a Pseudomonas infection, if you know the pathogens or suspected, highly suspected, depend upon previous culture report, colonization in that patient, you are using the two antimicrobials which act as against the Pseudomonas, then you say it is a combination. Two drugs, different mechanism, and one target, then it is a combination therapy. I hope so. I'm clear with the terminology. Now you choose your antimicrobials, you have to think about how much I have to give. You have to look for the understanding pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. You have to think about what is the age, gender, weight, status of other organs, patients or particular antimicrobials, volume of distribution, what we know, clearance variations in that particular patient. So we have to consider all these factors while you deciding how much dose I have to prescribe. You decided the antimicrobials, but dose how much? So depend upon the pharmacokinetics, various aspects. Like when there is a volume of distribution is more specifically in the sepsis because ongoing capillary leak, we need a high dose at the time of first time giving the drugs, increased loading doses for the antimicrobials which are having high volume of distribution during the sepsis, like amikacin, gentamicin, vancomycin, teicoplanin. So these drugs require in the high dose first time you prescribe it. Now you decided the antimicrobials, decided how much dose, but again question comes, how to give? Is there any rational or scientific background? How to give over 5 minutes bolus, 30 minutes infusions, short term, or prolonged infusions like 3-4 hours or something else. These are the basically has been studied that the killing of the bacteria or pathogens is decided by their understanding how that particular antimicrobial kill in a better way. For aminoglycoside, they kill the pathogen when they are in the very high concentration, 10 times of MIC. So these drugs has to be given as a single daily dose. High concentration, they kill more pathogens. Beta lactam, they doesn't need a high concentration to kill the pathogens, but they need a continuous exposure of these beta lactams, which are important for killing the bacteria. So all beta lactams like the penicillin, cephalosporin, carbapenems, monobactams, so which having the beta lactam ring, so these drugs kill pathogens effectively if you give the extended if infusion. Hello. Okay. Fluoroquinolones are the third type of antimicrobials which kill in a different way. They need both high concentration as well as sustained concentration for prolonged period of time to kill the maximum pathogens like fluoroquinolones. So fluoroquinolones, you have to give high dose at frequent intervals for that particular antibiotic. Source control, wherever there is a, you identify, diagnose where is the source, either intra-abdominal abscess, GI perforation, cholangitis, pyelonephritis, ongoing intestinal ischemia, bowel gangrene, skin soft tissue necrosis, empyema, septic arthritis, or infected intravascular devices. They need to be drained or removed as early as possible. When? Because as a bottom line, we know they have to be removed. I will come later on the timing of removal of the source control. From these guidelines, they highlighted use the vasopressors. It is a very much clear. Norepinephrine is a choice of vasopressors above the dopamine use. Always, first choice is to use the norepinephrine. How to prepare it? I hope that all of you must work in the ICUs. If you are a third year trainee, there are the variation in the preparation of the noradrenaline. But you can use this formula to know the exact dose of the norepinephrine what the patient is receiving. For that, you have to prepare as per the formula. Multiply body weight by the 0.3 factor. So that particular your result in the milligram of norepinephrine mix in the make a 50 ml normal saline. So if you prepare like this and run through infusion pump as a ml per hour, then exactly you can know how much patient is receiving that norepinephrine. I will say like body weight is a 70 kg. If you multiply by the 3, 21 milligram of norepinephrine, prepare it in the 50 ml. If you are giving through infusion pump as a 5 ml per hour, then that 5 ml, because I multiply by 0.3, you have to divide it by the 10. So 0.5 mice per kg per minute, exactly the patient is receiving that time. 1 ml per hour, if I run that preparation, it means patient is receiving 0.1 mics per kg per minute. If I am giving 2.5 ml per hour, means 0.25 mics per kg per minute patient is receiving. Exactly. If you prepare it right manner, then you know exactly what the dose patient is receiving. And you can mention in your notes as well as you can answer it. Rightly. Other aspects in this international guideline on sepsis, components just enumerating the use of the steroid. They say when the patient is either receiving a steroid, consider to continue steroid, or if it is not receiving earlier, Now you have done resuscitation adequately, there is a continued need of vasopressors. Time is again not defined, maybe one day, maybe 12 hours or 24 hours, you can consider to be a small dose of steroids. Again, a small dose, what is a small dose of steroids? You can say equivalent, if you see the literature, equivalent of hydrocortisone less than 400 or 500 milligram per day. You can give either as an intermittent boluses or infusion over 24 hours. Like if you decide, the commonly practiced use is a 200 to 300 milligram of hydrocortisone use per day in ongoing septic shock. So you can give either 50 milligram 6 hourly or 100 milligram IV 6 hourly, or you can run, make a preparation of 200 or 300 milligram and run over 24 hours. So this is the way. You can stop it abruptly or as a titrated way once your septic shock resolved. If septic shock continue, you can continue for days. No clarity about this one. Blood products, the threshold value earlier for the few cohort, they say even the elective operation theater earlier at our time, the training, that's but high risk 9 gram of hemoglobin you had to achieve. Say now slowly that things has been changed, 8 gram for few cohort of the patients. In the septic shock, 7 gram is a good enough. If the patient is having less than 7 hemoglobin, then only consider to give the PRVC, otherwise no. No need for correct deranged coagulation until unless you are going for invasive procedure. There is no need to correct the platelet, no need to correct the INR, because the sepsis is known to decrease the platelet count, increase your PT INR values. You have to look for that. Unnecessary transfusion is not advisable. Immunoglobulin, not used, not recommended. Blood purification, again, no enough evidence, not recommended. Anticoagulants, once you have done resuscitation, you rule out the ongoing coagulopathy, then consider anticoagulants. Mechanical ventilation, it is a part and parcel of ongoing septic shock. Patient may be conscious, patient may having the good oxygenation level, maintain saturation, maintain good PO2, but patient is receiving the vasopressors, especially high dose or worsening, better electively intubate and ventilate it. It's part of the management of the septic shock. Sedation and analgesia, of course, you have to give appropriate sedation analgesia. There is a high chances of stress-induced bleeding. So to tolerate the tube, to reduce the oxygen consumption, to ongoing resuscitation, when you decided for ventilation, then always consider appropriate sedation analgesia. Sugar control is always considered. Earlier it was recommended very tight control, like 80 to 110 milligram per deciliter. But that evidence slowly coming last 10 years against for that tight control. Called as IIT, especially in the terms of ICU, intensive insulin therapy. So now it is being discouraged and less evidence for that. Now recommendations are to maintain sugar between 120 to 180 milligram per deciliter. Can use the insulin infusion. Renal replacement therapy could be considered if there is an ongoing metabolic acidosis despite all your resuscitation. Bicarbonate therapy, not recommended. Usually, in fact, during resuscitation also, from the like the CPR guidelines, from the, in the severe septic shock, its evidence are less. Guideline does not support giving the routine use of bicarbonate therapy. Consider for DVT prophylaxis because the chances of venous stasis, venous thrombosis there, look for that. If you can give the no coagulopathy, consider to give it. Stress ulcer prophylaxis, always consider. ongoing septic shock, PPI. Nutrition, think early, no need, no hurry for first 1, 2, 3 days. But at least you have to maintain, you have to consider to give the dextrose at least 4 to 5 grams per hour, okay, in the adult patient. Then you can start as quickly as possible, next 3 to 5 days, the enteral nutrition. No need for parenteral nutrition in the initial days, absolutely no. Setting goal of care, you have to, it's a very advanced part of the expectations from the examiners, but yes, it is a part. A patient is landing in your ICU, already having the metastasis cancer or having the severe brain trauma, then you have to decide. These are the decisions from the senior experienced clinicians, the setting goal of these patients. So this is the basically main reference freely available through the online, and this guidelines are endorsed by various international organizations, and various experts had come out with these recommendations, and it is expected to come the fresh next few months also.
And free belief is recognized as a basic human right.
Second,
hello, consequences of untreated pain in a patient.
Hello. Okay. So the second part of this talk is a bench to bedside, because I had talked about a lot of the theory and a few definition and the concept last few minutes. Just few slides, how to correlate with day-to-day clinical practice being a PGU student and now going to join maybe further training in the super specialization or in your clinical practice, how to apply this one. Because giving the anesthesia, having patient sepsis is not uncommon, you encounter on and off. And the good outcome is defined by your timely pre-operative resuscitation, continue intraoperative ongoing optimization and stabilization, and again post-operative stabilization. So it is a continuous effort throughout the perioperative phase which have an influence on the outcome in these patients. Giving you a clinical scenario, through this case, I would like to highlight few aspects what the previous slides we had told. A 68-year-old male patient with history of fever and abdominal pain for 5 days on OPD basis management, now presented in the ER with severe excruciating abdominal pain with distension for last night. On examination, it was found hypotensive, systolic less than 90, peripheries were cold, capillary refill more than 5 seconds, pulse tachycardic, pulse rate 132, regular, temperature 101.4 degree Fahrenheit, respiratory rate 30 to 35 using accessory muscles. Saturations 94 on oxygen, difficulty in speaking full sentence. System-wise examination, normal CNS, but quite anxious. Peripheries are cold. Respiratory auscultation, bilateral basal crabs present. Abdomen examination, distended, flank full, guarding and tenderness present, bowel sound absent. And now after putting the Foley's catheter, there is a decreased urine output as well as the history that he did not pass urine last 12 hours. You had sent the blood gas, pH shows 7.12, PaO2 59, PaCO2 40, bicarb 10, lactate 3.4, base deficit minus 12. Laboratories report came, it shows hemoglobin 7.8, leukocytosis 29,000 TLCs, volume of increase 88%, low platelet count 70,000, blood sugar 102. and blood urea and nitrogen, as well as your LFT also drains. Sodium 140 normal, but potassium was towards higher side 5.1, and mild derange in the INR 1.35. Chest X-ray shows gas under the diaphragm. It confirmed the diagnosis of bowel perforation. We have been told that time is the life. The surgeon forces you. Okay, we have to operate because the source control is very important. So now, with available all your reports, it has been confirmed diagnosis of perforation. So diagnosed as a case of colonic perforation with septic shock with multi-organ dysfunction. Absolutely no doubt about the plan. Going for the surgery in this case, source control is very much needed. But many times in the real scenario, we had seen both things are possible. Patient may worsen post-operatively. Patient may not survive, or patient is survived. What would you like to? Ultimate outcome, everybody would be happy if we achieve the decrease in the morbidity and mortality. Okay, so, but how we can achieve this? Coming to the timing of the surgical treatment and outcome, everybody is very well aware that the time is life in this case. If, and the evidence also suggests, the previous evidence is, if you delay the hour of intervention, surgical intervention, chances of poor outcome. So even every few hours actually have an impact on the outcome. But in the recently, 3 years back, very large study, and they analyzed the data. Source control in patients with sepsis and septic shock from the European country analyzed 3,600 patients, and they specifically look the timing of the source control less than 12 hours or more than that. They did not identify impact on the outcome. They say the source control has an impact, but the timing does not have an impact. How it is possible? It is possible because it is not a timing. Other aspect, various aspects in the management of the sepsis which influence on the outcome. So you have to optimize before giving the anesthesia. You have to start your resuscitation timely, appropriately before going for the OT and source control. So not be in hurry. It is now through the evidence also. In this case, you see there are the various organs are at the verge of the dysfunction or the failure, cardiovascular involved, your respiratory, your renal, because of hypoperfusion, CNS looks like also, abdomen definitely, source of site of infection, and ABG also, all the variables in the ABGs are deranged. Acidotic patients, hypoxic patients, and acidosis both, because of the respiratory component as well as the metabolic, mainly the lactate. So your metabolic milieu is deranged along with your blood gases. You had a coagulopathy, you had a low platelet count, high creatinine, high potassium. You have to manage these aspects before going in the OT. Yes, I agree, early, but how early? It is a very well thought before you jump on giving the anesthesia in this patient. First, you have to optimize. In the brief, I can summarize that when you encounter the first time any patients and you identify patient is having sepsis or septic shock, your management and treatment started from that very first encounter, and it has an impact on the outcome. The earlier definition say the 6 hour, then 3 hour, then nowadays they recommended even the achieve the 1 hours. I will say they are the basically, if you summarize the core component in the resuscitation, they are the few, which again, repeating the things, like patient in the shock, consider for intravenous fluid, mainly crystalloid, can go 5 to 10 ml per kg aliquots of the fluid bolus and review periodically. Consider to take appropriate cultures, including the blood culture sample, see the lactate values, consider to give proper antimicrobials, need of vasopressors, start it early, do not wait for the response from the fluid, and repeat the assessment of the volume status and the lactate measurements. So again, if I further to just keep remembering the things, how to remember actually in the exam, when you seeing the first time the patient septic shock, you can remember two things out, two things in. What are the two things out? When you, two things out means, one is that take a culture, take a lactate value, means ABG, I can say. Take a sample the first time, if not done, for the ABG, including the lactate measurement. Take a blood for your cultures. So two things out. Two things in, what are those things? Timely fluid management, your antimicrobials. So two things in, fluid as quick as possible to start it, your antimicrobials as quick as possible to start it. Two things out, your ABGs, including the lactate measurements for the appropriate cultures collection blood, and two things in is that your fluid and the antimicrobials. If you remember it, it is, I think, good enough to give answer during your PG exit exam. For your patients, better outcome, as I told you, started the from the preoperative, intraoperative, postoperative. You continue to your resuscitation, optimization, and stabilization of all vitals. Supportive care like need of ventilator, even beforehand, before going to the operation theater, if ongoing septic shock, then you can consider to intubate preoperatively in well advance. Identify organ dysfunctions, your management will modify accordingly to that. And not only this, intra-op, even the post-operative, daily look for the changes in the vitals, each organ variables, parameters, as well as your laboratories and your prescription also, of course, to be modified accordingly. As we has been told during the your anesthesia training, that giving the anesthesia and recovering from the anesthesia, it is taking off and landing, the safe takeoff, safe landing, it is in your hand. So in this case of the patient having sepsis or septic shock, your ultimate outcome, in fact, start not only in the OR, your role start from well in advance when you see the patient the first time, as well as even the post-operative till the patient completely recover after the source control or surgery. Thank you.